Hello friends, welcome back in this video session of pharmaceutical analysis. Today we will be discussing the second part of complexometric titrations. In the first part we have seen what are complexometric titrations. So it is mainly the complex formation between the central metal ion, which is usually electropositive, with that of the complexing agent. So they form a complex, and that's why these are called as complexometric titrations. Here we use the indicator to detect the equivalence point of the titration. We have seen the principle of the complexometric titrations, what kind of bonding is involved in this formation of complexes. Then we have seen what is coordination number. So it is basically the number of ligands which can be accommodated by the central metal ion, and this central metal ion is electropositive. Therefore, the complexing agent which we are using, which are also referred as the ligands, they have the lone pair of electron, and then it form a coordinate covalent bond with that of the central metal ion. We have seen the ligands or complexing agents can be of different types based on the number of pair of electrons it has. It can be unidentate, it can be bidentate or tridentate or polydentate. We have seen EDTA is one of the most widely used titrant or the complexing agent in the complexometric titrations. We have seen what is the concept of chelate, what are chelating agents, what are sequestering agents, and the EDTA is one of the popular example of sequestering agents. So sequestering agents are nothing but these are the complexing agent which can form a water soluble complex. And usually in complexometric titration, as we use the aqueous media, we need the complexing agent which can form a water soluble complex. If the chelating agent is not forming water soluble complex, then we cannot use those as a chelating agent or complexing agent in the complexometric titrations. Okay, then we have seen why EDTA is widely used as a complexing agent in most of the complexometric titrations. Alright, now in today's session we will be again proceeding with the reagent EDTA. EDTA is ethylene diamine tetraacetic acid, and this EDTA purification sometimes is required. So purification of this disodium salt of EDTA is required because it does have some impurities, and if you are using as a standard solution in the burette or as a titrant, we should have the pure disodium EDTA. So these commercial samples of disodium EDTA may be purified for use as a secondary standard or the titrant in the burette by adding ethanol to a saturated aqueous solution until the first permanent precipitate appears. Then we can filter that precipitate, and on the precipitate we can again add the equal volume of ethanol. Then again we can filter that, the precipitate, and then the precipitated disodium EDTA we can wash with acetone and ether, and then we can dry to get a constant weight at 80 degrees Celsius. So we are ensuring that the whatever solvents we have added or which are present in the precipitate that have been evaporated at 80 degrees Celsius, and we are getting a constant weight, and this we can dry it for 4 days, and then this disodium EDTA is now become pure. And the official material of this disodium EDTA, it contains not less than 98% of the dihydrate. Okay, so this is a formula for the EDTA. So it is having a hydrated salt, it has two water molecules in that. Okay, so this is a procedure for purifying the disodium EDTA, which we are using as a widely complexing agent in the most of the complexometric titration. One of the reason we have seen why EDTA is used as a widely complexing agent, because it can be used at very low concentration. So we can use the EDTA at 0.05 molar concentration. So how we can prepare this 0.05 molar concentration of disodium EDTA? We can weigh accurately 18.6 grams of disodium EDTA in a sufficient water, and we have to make the volume to produce 1 liter or 1000 ml with the distilled water. And then we can store this in the polyethylene container so that it will be stable and it will not have any degradation problem. Then we can use it in the burette for the complexometric titration. So this is a preparation of the standard solution of disodium EDTA with concentration 0.05 molar. We can prepare at different concentration also based on the procedure or the requirement in the assay. As we know, whenever we prepare the standard solution, we need to practically verify what is the concentration of the prepared standard solution. So we can standardize the prepared solution of disodium EDTA. So this is a procedure for standardization of disodium EDTA. So as you know, for standardization of any standard solution, we require a primary standards. So here for complexometric titration, calcium carbonate CaCO3 is used as a primary standard. So we can weigh accurately about 200 mg of this calcium carbonate as a primary standard in the titration flask. We can add 50 ml of water and minimum quantity of dilute HCl so that this calcium carbonate can go into a solution. Okay, because it is inorganic substance, it is not freely soluble in water. We can make it solubilize by adding dilute HCl. Then we can adjust the pH of the solution with the sodium hydroxide solution. So the pH adjusted to 12. Okay, so it is alkaline, slightly alkaline pH. Then we can add 300 mg of hydroxyl naphthol blue indicator. Okay, so this is the indicator which we are using for getting the equivalence point. And then we can titrate with prepared 0.05 molar or M by 20 disodium EDTA solution until the solution converts to deep blue color. Okay, so this is a procedure for the standardization of disodium EDTA. The primary standard is calcium carbonate. We can also use some other primary standards like the pure zinc and so on, right? And then here we are using water and dilute HCl to solubilize the primary standard. Adjusting the pH, we are using the sodium hydroxide solution, and hydroxyl naphthol is a indicator in this particular titration. So what exactly happens when we perform the titration? Initially, you know, in the conical flask we have the calcium carbonate, then we have the solvent, and we have added the indicator. All right, now when indicator is present in the free form, it has a blue color. But the moment you add into a conical flask which already has the calcium ions in the form of calcium carbonate, so calcium can form a complex with the indicator. Okay, so initially the color of the indicator was blue, but when it is added into the primary standard solution of calcium carbonate, it can form a complex between the calcium and indicator, and this form complex is actually pink in color. Okay, so you will see the color of the solution in the conical flask is initially pink in color before you start the titration. Now you can fill the burette with the disodium EDTA of concentration 0.05 molar and you can start the titration. Now what you are doing, you are adding the drops of EDTA into this particular complex that is present in the conical flask. So what will happen, because the EDTA is a hexadentate ligand, it has 6 electron pairs which can be donated to the electropositive cation or the metal ion. So you can see, if you compare the ability of donating the electrons with that of the indicator, obviously the EDTA is more powerful when you compare the donation of the electrons. So what happens, the indicator is displaced by the EDTA because the calcium indicator complex is weak in nature. So in turn, the EDTA will compete with the indicator and indicator calcium complex will be broken down. So what is getting formed, right? As you are adding the EDTA from the burette to the flask, EDTA will take in place of indicator and it will form its own complex with that of the calcium. And what is happening here? Slowly, as you are proceeding the titration, the indicator is getting released in its free form. And you know, the original color of the indicator is blue. So you will see the transition of color in the conical flask from pink to faint pink and then faint pink to slightly yellowish, bluish color. So the blue is the end point of the titration. So titration, the color solution will be changing from pink to blue. That is the color change for this particular standardization. Okay, so this is how we can prepare the standard solution of EDTA of a particular concentration, and then we can practically verify by performing the standardization using the primary standard. Okay, so there are certain factors which will affect the EDTA reactions. First is the nature and activity of the metal ion, whether it is a divalent, whether it is a trivalent, and so on. Then pH at which the titration is carried out. Now in complexometric titration, the maintenance of the pH is very important, and that will have a great effect on the stability of the form metal, okay, or the complex. We will see that in the coming slide. The presence of interfering ions such as the Cn minus, the citrate, the tartarate, then fluorine and other complex forming agent, they will also interfere in the complex formation. And organic solvent, they usually increase the solubility of the complex. So these are several factors which affect the EDTA reaction, and these need to be taken into consideration whenever you are performing the complexometric titration. Now we'll see what are the aspects of complex formation with respect to the disodium EDTA, because the disodium EDTA is widely used complexing agent, so we are restricting our discussion with respect to this disodium EDTA. Okay, so we'll see the nature and the stability of the metal complexes of the disodium EDTA. Now this disodium EDTA will form a complex with the most cations in the 1:1 ratio, okay, irrespective of the valency of the ion. Now you can see here the metal, M represents the metal ion, and here the valency of the metal ion is +2. Here the valency of the metal ion is +3. Now this H2X, X is representing the complexing agent, okay. It has the two hydrogens, right. It is a dihydrate ion, right. So here X represents the complexing agent. Similarly, we can have here M3, M+3, right. So here 4, -4, +3, it will be -1. Then -4, +4, it will be neutral. Okay, it doesn't have any charge. Here -4 and +2, it will be having a -2. Okay, so the M is indicating the metal, and H2X -2 is an anion of the disodium salt. Okay, so this is most frequently used in the titration. So the structure of these complexes with di, tri and tetravalent metal ions, they contain 3, 4 and 5 rings respectively. Okay, so you can see this is the M, which is nothing but the metal ion. So this is a divalent. This is a divalent. So this divalent metal ion is forming a complex, and you can see once it has formed complex, it has resulted into 3 rings. If it is a trivalent, it is giving 4 rings. If it is a tetravalent, it is giving a 5 rings. 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 rings. Okay. So more the number of rings in the formed complex, more the stability of the complex. Okay. Then next is the effect of pH on the complex formation. Now EDTA ionizes in 4 stages of these pKa, 2.67, 6.16 and 10.26. And since the actual complexing agent is Y4-, complexes will form more efficiently and be more stable in the alkaline solution. So we see most of the times in complexometric titration, we perform the titration in the alkaline pH, and we add the buffer solution so that the pH will be maintained. This is because of the stability of the complex. If, however, the solubility product of the metal hydroxide is low, it may be precipitated if hydroxyl ion concentration is increased too much. Okay, so it depends on the sample. On the other hand, at lower pH, when the concentration of Y4- is lower, the stability of the complexes will not be so high. Okay, so it depends on the kind of metal ion you have and what kind of pH is required for getting the stable complex. Complexes of most divalent metal ions are stable in ammonical solution. Okay, so this is what I was talking about in the previous slide. So here the divalent metal ions are stable in the ammonical solution. Those of alkaline earth metals such as copper, lead and nickel, they are stable down to pH 3. So it depends on the analyte or the metal, and hence these which are stable at pH 3 can be titrated selectively even in presence of the metal, earth metals, right? Trivalent metal complexes are usually still more firmly bound and stable in the strongly acidic solutions. For example, the cobalt EDTA complex is stable in the concentrated hydrochloric acid. Okay, although most complexes are stable over a fair range of pH, solution are usually buffered at pH at which the complex is stable and at which the color change of the indicator is more distinct, so that we can easily observe the end point of the titration. Color of the complexes, there is always a change in the absorption spectrum when the complex are getting formed, and this can be considered as a basis for the colorimetric assays. We have seen most of the analytes which are the colorless analytes. So if you want to measure them quantitatively with the colorimetric estimation methods, you need to convert them into a colored complex. Okay, for example, the salicylic acid. So we use a ferric chloride and then it form a complex, and this complex becomes colored, and then we can measure it very comfortably with the colorimetric assay. Okay, so usually the complex formation will result into a colored complex, and because of the colored complex we can quantify them with the colorimetric or the other kind of methods. Then next is the stability of the complexes. So the general equation for the formation of 1:1 chelate complex, right, Mx, so here M is the metal ion and X is the chelating agent. Okay, so this is the metal ion and this is the chelating agent. So they are interacting with each other, they are forming a complex through the coordinate covalent bond, and then we can decide the stability constant of this particular complex formation reaction. So stability constant K is equal to, as per the law of mass action, you can see the concentration of the product, that is Mx, the complex formation, divided by the concentration of the reactants, that is the concentration of metal ion or the cation and the chelating agent. It represents the activity or the concentration, right? So increase in temperature can cause slight increase in the ionization of the complex and slight lowering of the K. Okay, not much, but there is a slight effect on the stability of the complex, of the form complex by the temperature. Okay, so titration with respect to disodium EDTA. So here again, we can have the titration curve, we can get idea about the change and how the endpoints can be visualized here. So many principles of the acid based titrations can also be extended here in the complexometric titration. In complexometric titration, the free metal ion disappear, right? Free metal ion disappear because it is going to form a complex with that of the complexing agent, right? In acid based titration, the endpoint is marked by sudden change in the pH. We have seen with the phenolphthalein indicator with the acid based series. Similarly, in EDTA titration, if we plot the PM, what is PM? PM is nothing but the negative log of metal ion concentration. Okay, PM is nothing but the negative log of metal ion concentration versus we take a volume of titrant, that is the disodium EDTA. So on y-axis you can take the PM concentration, and on x-axis you can take the volume of the titrant, that is disodium EDTA. So we can find at the end point there is a rapid increase in the concentration of the PM, and that makes the end point which is visualized by observing a color change. So this sudden change in the PM concentration is due to the removal of traces of metal ions from the solution by the EDTA. Any method which we can determine this particular change can be used as a basis for detection of endpoint in the complexometric titration. So this is how exactly the titration curve can be plotted in the complexometric titration. On x-axis we are taking the volume of titrant, and here you can see on y-axis you can take PM, which is nothing but the minus log of concentration of metal ions, and you can see there is a drastic increase in the negative log of concentration of metal ions. Okay, so this is positive towards the downside, so there is an increase, rapid increase in the PM. Okay, so that is actually the end point of the complexometric titrations. So there are certain factors which can affect the magnitude of break in titration curve, that is what we can observe it as a end point, and the reaction is completing, that we can refer it as a practical endpoint, which is nothing but the equivalence point. So the first factor that is affecting is the stability of the complex form. So the greater the stability of the complex, obviously the larger charge in free metal concentration at equivalent point, and more clear would be the end point. Okay, so the stability of the complex plays an important role. So you have to maintain the conditions during the reaction, complex formation reaction, which can lead to a stable complex formation, and one of the important factor there is the pH of the solution. Second is the number of steps involved in the complex formation. Most of the times there are very few number of steps involved in the complex formation, so that is good for the complexometric titration. Fewer the number of steps required in the formation of complex, greater would be the break in titration curve at equivalence point, and clear or distinct color change or the endpoint would be observed. Effect of pH is playing a very important role in the titrations like complexometry, and we need to use a buffer solution which can reduce the change in the pH. So during complexometric titration, the pH must be constant, so we can use a buffer solution, and control of pH is important since the H plus ions always plays an important role in the chelation. Okay, chelation is nothing but the complex formation. Most ligands are basic and bind to H plus ions. Okay, and throughout a wide range of pH, they can form a binding between the ligand and H plus ions. And some of these H plus ions are frequently displaced from ligands by metal during the chelate formation. So you can see the metal ion is also electropositive, and if at all the H plus ions are present in the solution or during the complex formation, we have seen in the earlier slide there is a generation of H plus ions. So these H plus ions can compete with the metal ion for binding with that of the EDTA or the complex engagement. Alright, what I am saying, the generated H plus ions can also compete with that of the metal ion, because both have the positive charge. Here also it is a positive charge, here also it is a positive charge, and the ligands are basic in nature, so they have the negative charge. So there is a possibility that the H plus ions can compete the metal ion for binding with the disodium EDTA. Okay, and if this is happening, then we will not get accurate results. To avoid this, what we can do, we can add a buffer solution which will maintain the pH, and the H plus ions in that case will not compete with that of the complexing agent. Okay, so this is all about in the today's session. In the next session we will see the types of complexometric titration and the applications of complexometric titration in the coming video. Thank you.